Okay, so after all that hard work going through Anna Williams' move list, I decided to take Anna on a vacation. So she's in her bikini and we've gone to the holiday resort for a bit of R&R. And really in this section, what I just want to do is just go over any things that I missed, because there are a couple of things that I did miss when I was going through the move list. And also then just talk about general strategy and how to approach fighting with Anna. So let's go ahead and talk about some little extra things that weren't in the move list. Okay, so the first extra kind of Easter egg that I want to talk about is the fact that she does have a kind of a just frame. I can't remember if it does have the just frame blue sparks or not, but hopefully we'll be able to check that in a minute. Okay, so first of all, I've got to say that I'm not the best at this just frame. I find it quite tricky to execute properly, so this may be quite a few tries before I get it. If it's like loads of tries, then I'll edit it out, just until we get the right thing. But it's the just frame is from her forward 3-4 that goes into chaos. So forward 3-4 back 3. The transition into chaos from that move. That's where you get the just frame from. And the just frame is done by pressing 1 plus 2 almost exactly as she enters Chaos Judgment Stance. Now, what you'll get when you do it correctly is actually the unblockable. It's actually Hunting Swan, funnily enough. That's the just frame. I think it's a little bit quicker. It still gives you the combo that you can do off the normal Hunting Swan. But that's what the just frame actually is. So let me go ahead and try and execute this just frame for you. Okay, I got it. I did finally get it. Yeah, that kind of took a while. I'll be honest with you, it did take a while, so that's why I edited the unsuccessful ones out just to save time. But what you saw there was the Hunting Swan come directly out of the forward 3 transition into chaos. Now, the fact that I suck at this just frame doesn't really bother me that much because, to be honest with you, compared to some characters' just frames that are, really integral to their whole game. I mean, Hwarang with his just frame skyrocket, which you really want to be able to do properly, or things like Paul's Demolition Man, also that's really useful to be able to do that consistently, and even things that maybe aren't true just frames, like the Electric Wind God Fists, that at max speed, the quickest version of Electric Wind God Fists, again, really crucial to Mishima's. With Anna, this just frame, it just is not useful. And if you can't do it, you won't miss it. Trust me, you won't miss it. I mean, at the wall, if you end your combo with forward 3-4 back 3 at the wall, then you can get the unblockable to hit. But honestly, if you can't do it, do not beat yourself up over the fact that you can't get this to come out. It's really not a big deal. It's just a huge gimmick, and it doesn't even have any evasive properties. The actual unblockable from the Chaos Judgment Stance doesn't really evade anything or anything like that. So, trust me, you're not missing out on it. But I just thought I would mention it because it is there. Okay, so another move that's actually not listed in the move list that we went through from Chaos Judgment Stance is her hip bump, forward 2 plus 3. You can actually do that from Chaos Judgment Stance just by pressing forward 2 plus 3, same notation. So that's available to you from Chaos Judgment Stance as well, and that's a lot more useful than the than the unblockable. you'll definitely find a use for that. Just as a quick move amid, you know, it is useful to be able to do the hit bump from Chaos Judgment Stance, so I missed that out. Okay, so for the last secret move that I want to talk about, I just want to give shout out to Tekken Zaibatsu, which is a website where people post information, any strategy that they've come up with. It's a really great website and it's still being updated, you know, even now, a few years after the game has come out. It's still being updated, so definitely give it a look. Because that's where I found out about this, was on Tekken Zaibatsu, so big props to them. I can't remember who exactly posted it, but yeah, definitely a great website. So what it is, it's a bit complicated, so let me try and go through it as thoroughly as possible. So from her normal moveset, she has access to the Guard Breaker down forward 1+2 move, the kind of offensive shove, which we've talked about, and is +1 on block, +5 on hit, and +19 on counter hit. So we know about that. But there does actually exist a stronger version of this move, a buffed up version of this offensive shove. And you only have access to it by... It's sort of a just frame cancel to her Chaos Judgment Stance. Which is kind of funny because when I was doing the Chaos Judgment Stance moves, you know, I was talking about how, oh, she doesn't have a cancel. There's no cancel to Chaos Judgment Stance. There seems to be sort of a cancel. And how you do it is almost as soon as you get into Chaos Judgment Stance, you press down forward 1+2, so the same notation as for your Guard Breaker from normal move list. If you press down forward 1+2, you know, really, really quickly, or really at the exact moment that she's going into Chaos Judgment Stance, then she will execute a buffed up, it's like an uber Guard Breaker, you know, it's. I mean, why I'm saying that it's buffed up is because, so normal down forward 1+2, +1 on block, which is okay, it's not a lot, but the cancel version is, I think it must be about +5 on block. There's no frame data for it because, well, I mean, it's not listed on any frame data websites, so either it's relatively a new discovery, or people just haven't listed it there because they're unsure. But when I tested it, it seemed to be about +5. You know, I just tested it by doing the move and seeing what was uninterruptible after the move was blocked. And it seemed like things like Anna's hip bump, 2+3, forward 2+3, that seemed to be uninterruptible after the buffed up Guard Breaker. So I would think it's about +5. So as I say, it's a lot stronger than the normal version. So that's, you know, it's pretty crazy. You know, to me, I just think that, because at first I kind of thought that it might be a glitch, that it might be sort of just the fact that you haven't quite got into Chaos Judgment Stance yet and you're getting the Guard Breaker kind of by accident, you know, it's just a glitch with the stance. But the fact that it's got different frame data than the regular version, that kind of makes me think maybe it was actually intentional. Maybe the developers did program this in, because why would it have different frame data? That doesn't make sense to me. So that's kind of crazy to me to think that they actually programmed this, you know, buffed up version, and it's taken us all this time to really discover it. So let me try and show you what it actually, I mean, it looks the same as the normal Guard Breaker, but I'll just try and execute it. Hopefully you'll see that I'm trying to go into Chaos Judgment Stance and then I'm coming out of it with the Guard Breaker. Okay, that was it there. That did take me quite a few tries to actually get that to come out. It's really not the easiest thing in the world. That's why I'm saying that it's just frame, because the timing on it is so strict that, I mean, you really have to be... It must be sort of a just frame thing. If it was intentional, then it's kind of a just frame thing. But that was... I mean, it just looks the same as the normal down forward 1 plus 2. There's no difference to the animation. But, as I say, there is a big difference with the frames. So, I mean, the normal thing that you'll get from Chaos Judgment Stance if you press down forward 1 plus 2 is the throw. You know, that's what you'll get if you don't do it quickly enough, then you'll get the throw instead. So even that's not a terrible mistake. You know, it's not that bad. But yeah, it's really difficult to execute consistently. I mean, it's like the possibilities for using it. You know, I kind of get really excited about it because it could be so good, especially against the wall, because people just, well, for one thing, people are going to think, you know, even if they know the frame data on down forward 1 plus 2, they might see this move come out, you know, from the cancel from the Chaos Judgment Stance. They might see the guard breaker come out and think, oh, okay, it's only plus 1, you know, not that scared of that. But it's going to be actually plus a lot more, and there's so many possibilities, and it's such a great tool because it's plus quite a lot, and it's mid, and yeah, it's definitely exciting, but it is really difficult to do. So it's more frames on block, more plus frames on block. It's also more plus frames on hit and more plus frames on counter hit. So all the way along the line, it's buffed up. You know, each version of it is stronger than the normal down forward 1 plus 2. So I'm not sure about it on hit, what it, how many frames it is on hit. You see, I got it there, did get it there, and again, but you know, it is quite difficult to do consistently. But yeah, so what was I saying? On hit, I'm not sure how many frames it is on hit. I think it might be plus 10 frames on normal hit or something like that. Now on counter hit, so we talked about the normal version of down forward 1 plus 2, how that gives you plus 19. So you get a guaranteed forward 3 on counter hit. Now, the buffed up version of down forward 1 plus 2 gives you a lot more frames on counter hit. It's crazy. It is actually pretty insane because I tested this against the wall, and if you get the... if you get the cancel from Chaos Judgment Stance, so the cancel down forward 1 plus 2 to hit on counter hit, then this move is actually a combo. Down back 3 plus 4, 3 will actually combo off the buffed down forward 1 plus 2. So let me try and show you that at the wall. Okay, so that look, as you can see there, that was a 3-hit combo. So it's counting the buffed version of down forward 1 plus 2 as part of the combo. You know, so that is, it's crazy. I do kind of get a little bit just overwhelmed by this because it's you know, just the possibilities of what you could do with this is kind of blowing my mind at the moment. So forgive me if I'm a little bit all at sixes and sevens, because I just, I'm kind of excited to try and use this and mess people up with it. That's to be honest with you, that's what's exciting me, is the fact that I could really, I could really screw people over with this cancel. But I need to practice executing it consistently. I think it helps if you press, almost as if you're pressing the down forward motion for the down forward 1+2, kind of even before you're finished pressing back 3. So it's kind of like you don't even really finish pressing the back 3 and you just go for the down forward motion as fast as you can. That seems to work for me quite often. I'm not sure, because obviously Anna has a few different transitions into Chaos Judgment Stance. I'm using back 3 as an example because it's kind of the easiest, but she can do it from all her transitions. You know, her while standing 3, you could get the offensive shove to come out from that, I'm pretty sure. Forward 3-4, back 3. So this into Chaos, I'm pretty sure you could get that, which would also be pretty amazing because that's only -1 on block. This transition is only -1 on block, so that could be quite viable. So yeah, definitely a ton of possibilities for this move, and let's see what happens with this move. It's gonna be. Okay, so the final secret Anna tech is to do with her reversal. So back 1+3 or back 2+4. Now, I talked about this way back at the start of the tutorial, and I mentioned it as a generic reversal. Now, this is also something that actually somebody put a comment in the comment section. His name was Infundibular, so something like that. So he put a comment that it's not actually a standard reversal, and I was like, really? But he said that it can actually reverse some shoulders, and I was like, I was kind of skeptical at first. I kind of thought, oh, I think you're mistaken about that. But I went into practice mode and I tested it, and it's actually true. She has a unique reversal. So her reversal is different from everyone else's, even Asuka's. You know, Asuka is kind of the queen of reversals. You might think that because she does a lot of them. But her reversals can't reverse the moves that Anna can reverse. Anna can reverse more moves than Asuka can, and she's the only one that can reverse some moves. So the moves that I'm talking about are things like Paul's forward 1+4. Let me get Paul in here and we will have a look at this. So bye bye Nina. Okay, let's program in the forward 1+4. You see, I managed to reverse that, and that is a shoulder. Okay, that is supposed to be a shoulder. It's not supposed to be able to be reversed. And if you try and reverse that with Asuka or any other character, you know, Nina, you know, any character that has a standard reversal that kind of looks like that, they cannot reverse that. Anna is the only one who can reverse that. So this is another thing that just makes me kind of like, wow, I just can't believe that I did not know that. And you know, it's amazing. And there's actually quite a few moves that she can reverse that other characters cannot reverse. With Paul, again, as an example, his forward 4, let me show you that move. this move. Okay, this is sort of a whole body move. So he's in the air, he's kind of using his whole body to attack with. This move normally cannot be reversed by any character. It can be parried by Wang and Jin, but it can't actually be reversed for damage with generic reversals. But again, Anna can reverse this move. So let's program this in and we'll have a look at that as well. It's quite tricky, the timing on this one. You know, that's just... She reversed that, you know. It's, you know, I think it's pretty amazing. And a big shout out to, again, Infundibular for mentioning that in the comment section. I really appreciate it. And it is really, it's pretty amazing. So there you go. Her reversal is not a generic reversal. It is the best reversal in the game. Okay, so now that we've covered all the kind of secret stuff that I left out, I want to get on to some strategy things, and I want to start with Chaos Judgment, because you have to be aware that, let's use forward, forward, 3-4, back 3, so this transition as our example, because this is only minus 1 on block. Okay, that transition is only minus 1 on block. So you might think that you've got, you know, you can do quite a lot from there. You've got a lot of options in what you want to do. In reality, the reality of it is that almost every option after the forward, forward, 3-4, back 3 into Chaos, almost every option will be beat out by a standing 4. So if your opponent does a standing 4 after that transition, they will beat almost everything, including your high crushes. So your down back 3-3 is supposed to be a high crush. You will get counter hit by the 4. So let me show you this. We've got Anna here as the computer opponent. She is going to do forward, forward, 3-4, back 3, into Chaos, and right away she's going to do down back 3-3. So let's just set that. I'll just show you first of all. So that's what she's going to do. Now I'm just going to press 4, so the standard 11 frame 4, after she does the transition, and you will see what happens. It did not crush that 4. So that 4 will beat out that. This is also true for Chaos 4. If the computer Anna was to do Chaos 4, that wouldn't crush it wouldn't crush my standing 4 either. Okay? You would get hit by the standing 4. So what does that mean? That means that you actually you are quite limited in what you can do after your Chaos transitions are blocked. On hit, of course, it's different. If you can get your while standing 3 to hit and go into Chaos that way, you don't really have to worry about that too much. But you've got to be aware that certain transitions, a standing 4 will beat almost everything. I mean, I'll show you again with the jab, the 2-1 from Chaos. Let me just check to see if I've got the right thing here. Yeah, so this little jab combo, which is the fastest move out of Chaos. Now, I think that will trade with my standing 4. I think it will trade with that. Just let me turn counter hit off. So let's see what happens with the standing for. Managed to beat me out. But it should trade. Yeah, it should trade. I mean, they have to kind of mash it. Oops. Yeah, it will trade. If they press the 4 quick enough, it will trade. And that's a bad trade for you because their standing 4 is likely to be a lot more frame advantage than your Chaos 2. So you will be the loser in that trade. So you've got to be aware that a standing 4 is kind of your nemesis when you go into Chaos on block. There is one option that will beat an opponent's standing 4. So let me make the computer do this one. And that option is to go into your crouch dash after the Chaos transition, and crouch dash 4 should beat my standing 4. Let's just give that a try. It will. So that's your that's one thing you can do to get around your opponent's standing 4, because remember, you can't block when you're in Chaos, so it's not as if you can just do nothing. And you know, you've got to do something to avoid getting hit by that standing 4. You know, you've got to do something. So that's what you can do to beat that out. But it's the only thing that will beat that. So that's something to be aware of. Another weakness for your Chaos Judgment game is, so when you're strategizing about how you want to use Chaos Judgment stance, a lot of players will kind of think, okay, so I'm going into Chaos Judgment stance. That means that they're not going to use any lows against me, they're not going to use down jabs against me, because that will be, I will counter them, you know, it will auto counter the lows and the down jabs, and they will get launched. So a lot of the time you kind of discount that as, you know, your opponent isn't going to do that. But if your opponent is quite knowledgeable, then they will know that when you're in Chaos Judgment stance, you can't block. So you're unlikely to just go into Chaos Judgment stance and do nothing and just retain the the auto counter, the auto low counter and the auto throw reversal. You're unlikely to just be idle in Chaos Judgment stance. You're more likely to do a move out of your stance. So what that means is, as soon as you input a move from Chaos Judgment stance, all the auto reversal powers of the stance no longer apply. So if I do a move from Chaos Judgment stance, then I will not be able to auto counter lows or throws anymore. So if your opponent knows this, and they know that you're probably not just going to remain in Chaos Judgment stance without doing a move, then what that does is that opens up their down jabs again. You know, they're kind of free to do their down jabs again because they know that you're probably going to do something. You know, you're not going to just stay in Chaos without doing anything. So that allows them to use their down jabs again, or their lows, you know, toe kick. It opens up those options for them again. So you've got to be aware of that. You've got to be aware that that is a possibility that might happen to you, is that even if they know Chaos Judgment stance auto hop kicks down jabs, they may still do it because they may think he's going to do a move. So in this scenario, so let's use our programmed options in again. Let's start with the low. So if I see this Ana player go into Chaos from the forward 3-4 back 3, I'm pretty sure that she is going to do something after that. She's not just going to stay in Chaos without doing a move. So I'm going to down jab. And you see there, that was not auto countered because the computer Ana was doing a move. So I didn't get launched for doing the down jab. So that makes things a little bit more tricky as well. So the only option that would beat that would be to do the hop kick out of chaos. Do the transition and then hop kick. That's the only thing that would beat that down jab. Obviously with the jab combo. Beat it out again. And let's just try the crouch dash to crouch dash 4. And that beat that as well. So what I'm trying to say is that transitioning to chaos can be really tricky to make it work for you, because standing 4 will beat 99% of your options, as well a down jab. I mean, of course, if the opponent was to just stay in chaos and not do a move after the transition, then of course I would get launched for down jabbing. But as I say, that's unlikely, because they can't block highs and mids. So, you know, these are all things that you've got to bear in mind when you're thinking about using Chaos Judgment Stance. You've got to bear in mind that your opponent has ways around your stance transitions. So definitely just be aware of it and think it. Okay, so next I want to talk about something called Yomi, which is also called Metagame. And this is just really, it's thinking ahead. It's anticipating what your opponent is going to do based on what they have done, and trying to beat their strategy. And you do kind of have to think ahead in at least two steps ahead, I would recommend. Let me try and explain to you what I mean, because this is kind of difficult to explain clearly. It's sort of something that you just do in your own head, intuitively, you know, naturally. You kind of just do it automatically, so it's quite difficult to actually explain. But let's use quarter circle forward 1, the elbow with Anna. Let's use this as our sort of example for metagame. So this elbow is about +2 on block. So if you use this move, say you were going to use this move and do a standing 4 afterwards as a sort of counter hit, as a fish for a counter hit, you thought, okay, this is plus on block, they might try and attack, I'm going to do a magic 4 and possibly get a counter hit combo. So I've got this programmed in here. So if you do this kind of strategy, quarter circle forward 1 into standing 4, obviously this can be beat out by lows. So I've got the computer programmed in to do that. Yep, quarter circle forward 1 into standing 4. So if they do this, then I could crush the standing 4 and beat them out that way. So say if you'd done quarter circle forward 1 into standing 4 and your opponent had crushed it with either a low or a down jab, you've got to take note of that, okay? You've got to remember that for the next time that you do quarter circle forward 1. I mean, the first way that you would anticipate your opponent, and the first way that you would try to get around them, is by trying to crush their low. Because remember, you did this quarter circle forward 1, and they did a low after that. So you might think, okay, maybe they're going to do that again. I'm going to crush that low with... the flip kick is a bit dangerous. Let me just show you why the flip kick is not the easiest thing for that strategy. I think this is the right one that I've programmed in here. Okay, yeah. So, this quarter circle forward 1 is +2 on block. And if your opponent had done a low, you might think, okay, I'll do my flip kick and I will launch them for doing the low. But if I down jab after the quarter circle forward one, the flip kick will not crush it. Or it shouldn't do. It's mashed. Yeah, the down jab can't... It can come out before the flip kick. Oops, did it too fast there. It can beat out the flip kick, so that's what's a bit kind of rubbish about your flip kick. But you could always use something like up three or up forward three, you know, something like that. Or you could always sidestep if they were doing a down jab. So let's just see here. I think it might be this one that's sidestep. Yeah, so so that beat out the down jab. I mean, that won't work for some lows, because some lows have tracking. So what I'm trying to say with this is that you've got to bear in mind what your opponent has done after certain moves. So after, say for example, a quarter circle forward one, and they do a low, and you think about how you're going to counter the low. That's the basic level of metagame. But I would recommend, and this is a bit more difficult, I would recommend thinking at least two steps ahead. So let me explain what I mean by this. So we're in the situation that you did quarter circle forward one once before, and they did a low. The last time you used quarter circle forward one, they did a low. So you might think, if you're thinking one step ahead, you would think that you might want to crush that low. But if your opponent has remembered that they did a low the last time that you did quarter circle forward one, they might expect you to try and crush it with a hop kick. So instead of doing a low, they might do a jab. If you're understanding what I mean, it's kind of complicated to talk about. It's more of a sort of mind process thing. But I would recommend trying to think at least two steps ahead. So in that scenario, if I was fighting against a reasonably clever opponent who I thought, okay, maybe he's remembered that I did quarter circle forward one, maybe he's remembered that he did a low last time, and he's expecting me to try and hop kick it or to try and crush it. So maybe he's going to try and float me out of my hop kick, because you've got to remember that quarter circle forward one is only plus two. So you know, you could get floated out of trying to hop kick it by a jab. If your opponent did a jab, they could float you. So you've got to remember that. So I might be expecting them not to do a low the second time after this is blocked. I might not be expecting a low. I might actually think two steps ahead and be expecting a jab. So then I might try and actually crush the jab with a low of my own. What's good about that as well is that if your opponent was only thinking one step ahead and actually did a low for the second time, so they just do the same thing as they did the first time, so two lows after, you know, this quarter circle forward one is blocked, then you're probably going to beat their low anyway with your own low, because you've got frame advantage. You're probably going to beat their low, so that will probably also beat your opponent if your opponent is only thinking one step ahead. I hope I'm explaining this clearly. I don't feel like I am. I feel like it's a little bit jumbled up. It's trying to, I mean, there are players who think like three steps ahead. You know, that's where you're thinking, you know, you're thinking about them second-guessing you, and then you second-guess them, and I mean, that's called Yomi, that's called metagame, and it is quite important. I would recommend two steps ahead. So have, be thinking of possible ways that they might counter you. And you have to do this by, you have to remember what they did in certain setups or after your moves. You know, this is the example, Quarter-Circle Forward 1, but I mean, we could talk about, you know, what do they do after forward 2? So the move that gives you a lot of frame advantage, this gives you plus 5 if this is blocked. If they do happen to beat out your follow-up after forward 2, remember what they did. Remember what they did, but also remember that they might be trying to anticipate what you're going to do to beat them the next time. I hope this is clear, but I've got a feeling that I might just be waffling on and no one's understanding what I'm talking about. But please leave a comment if this is making sense to you, or if it's not. If this doesn't make any sense to you at all, then put it in the comments section and I might try and redo it, or try and put it into writing or something. Because I don't feel like I'm really doing it any justice. But that is something that you have to, for Ana players, I think is especially important, because she does rely on her mix-ups and she relies on anticipating what her opponent is going to do. So that's why I'm talking about it, you know, giving it special mention, because I do feel it's actually quite important. Okay guys, so we are actually almost done with this tutorial. It's been quite a long quite a long one, that's for sure. It's really taken, but hopefully I've been thorough, you know, hopefully I've covered everything in detail and made sure that I've left no gaps. So hopefully you've got all the information you needed. Now, the reason why I was so thorough and the reason why I did talk for so long about, you know, each individual move in her move list and all that stuff was because I didn't want this tutorial to be me telling you which moves to use, me saying that, you know, okay, you should just use this move and use this move and just, you know, do X, do Y, do Z. I wanted you to use the information that I was giving you about the moves to build your own set of moves that you liked, or you liked using, that you thought were effective, you know, just based on the hints and tips that I'd maybe given you. Because I think what helps people, just strategy in general, is if they develop their own strategy and then other people can learn from what they've done, and it can kind of grow that way. You know, Ana players can learn from each other. So if I was to tell you exactly what to do, that wouldn't happen. You know, it would just be everyone would just play the same way. So hopefully you can develop your own Ana Williams, your own Ana that can be, you know, effective in Tekken. And then other people can take stuff from you. So hopefully that's what this tutorial has done. It's given you the information you need. I mean, if you're still unclear, I will just quickly mention the key moves that you should be using to build your character around. And I would say they would be things like Quarter-Circle Forward 1. Okay, this is quite good for starting your offense. I would say you want to use Down Forward 4 for a low poke that gives you advantage, and to set up Sidestep to set up evasion. Quite good for that. You want to use Forward 3, this move, as a whiff punisher. If they whiff a move, you can launch them with that. Forward 2 is good for tracking if they're sidestepping, and it's good for setting up your own offense, you know, getting in and start your own attack patterns. And Quarter-Circle Forward 4 is good for, again, homing if they're sidestepping. It will track quite a lot, so it's good for that. A good mid poke would be Down Forward 1, and all the extensions that come after that for variation to mix them up. Your full crouch game, Down Forward 2, and your mids, you definitely want to find ways of using them. Possibly you can use your down back one to set that up. Down back one is also good for the mix-up factor, you know. So those are pretty much some of the key moves that you want to use. I mean, also obviously your punishers, I've told you what punishers to use, so you've got your punishment all sorted, that's ready to go, you know what to do in terms of that. And yeah, hopefully you will be the next big Ana player. So good luck guys, and thanks for watching this tutorial. If you've watched it all the way through, then you're a star, and thank you very, very much. And please like these videos and maybe subscribe if you enjoyed it. I'll hopefully be trying to do more videos, and yeah, so thanks everyone, bye.